Let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, Lord, we do pray that you would shine your light upon us. Even more, we pray that we would shine your light out into the world, that people might see the glory of your Father, that they'd see the glory of your name. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Well, God's grace and his mercy and his peace be to you from God the Father and our Lord and our Savior Jesus. Good morning. The word of God that we're going to look at today is from Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 to 20, specifically verses 13 to 16. So I'd actually invite you guys to open up your Bible or kind of turn on your personal device or whatever that best way for you to access the scriptures today. And we're going to look at that together. And you heard Pastor Mike read this earlier. And today's gospel for me, when I started preparing for today, it kind of brought me back in time to a couple of different places where I have been in the past. The first, as you can surmise, is Israel. And we talked about this last week and kind of going back to the Mount of Beatitudes, not the pristine manicured one, but rather the one that may look a little bit more like where Jesus taught from. We're going to talk more about that in a little bit. But the other place that I was drawn to was back to the garage where my father was working on the car. Now, I'm guessing I was probably 7 or 8 years old, somewhere in that age range. And I think my dad was working on the shocks on the car. And my dad didn't work on the car a lot, but I can remember him working on the shocks, and he needed my help. Now, there's a big difference between your father wanting you to rake the leaves or vacuum the floor or clean up the mess after you. There's a big difference between that and him needing your help. You know, he would always say that, I need you to rake the leaves, I need you to this, but he really didn't need me to do that, just so you get it. He wanted me to do that, but he could have done that himself, or he could have gotten one of my sisters to do it. But this time, he needed my help with the car. I was my father's light, or at least his light holder while we were working on the car. You see, when you're working on a car and you're trying to find a nut or a bolt in the dark recesses of the wheel well, you need somebody, you really do need somebody to hold the light for you. To complete the job, do it right, you gotta have some light. Now, I will admit that the idea of helping my dad, the initial, I need your help, the adventure and excitement of that quickly wore off after a short period of time. It wasn't nearly as exciting as I thought it was going to be to help him in doing that, but yet I did that. In fact, you might say that as I was watching him, I was thinking to myself, you know, turning that wrench might be a little bit more exciting than just holding the light. And the result was that at least once, actually probably at least a dozen times or so, he would say something to the effect of, can you put the light where I can see? Can you hold the light steady? Don't shine the light in my face. I need it over here. You know, those kinds of things. It was something that started out exciting, but then got kind of tedious. And it was easy for me to become distracted in doing that. And in the midst of all that, when we finally got near the end, as we got close to the completion of the job, there was still a sense of pride and satisfaction as my mom came out checking on her men, you know, to see how the job was going, to see if we were done. And we did get done. you know, my dad did the heavy lifting, but I was his light. I was the light of the garage. Now, as I go back to my childhood and I think about all that, it made me start to wonder, in light of the scripture, do I have the same sense of excitement, the same sense of accomplishment about being my Heavenly Father's light, being more than just the light of the garage, but the light of the world? Do I have the same view toward that? Did I see it as exciting when I was first called to shine that light? But has it become a little tedious since then? And have I failed to shine it in the right place at the right time? Now, is there something I'd rather be doing? A different job? Now, as you think about those questions, maybe that kind of sparks some questions for you in your own personal discipleship journey, in your own walk with Jesus. And if so, then I think that's where we need to go back to this place, to this mountain where Jesus shared the words that we heard today. To hear him say the Beatitudes again to us, that says we are blessed. And that's kind of the identity of who we are. That's what Jesus, what we talked about last week, the identity of being blessed. But then Jesus says, you are salt and you are light. He moves from our identity to our calling to be salt and light into the world. The first thing to note, and this is where I'd like you to kind of go back to your scripture there, the first thing to note is that Jesus does not tell his disciples to be salt. He does not tell them to be salty or to be light. He says, verse 13, and then again in 14, he says, you are. You are the salt of the earth. We are the salt of the earth. We are the light of the world. In other words, what Jesus is saying is we are the ones to do this. It is not just the calling of anybody. It is not the responsibility of every person in the world. It is ours. We are the ones who need to do this because of who we are. If we don't, then the question becomes, who will? If we are the salt of the earth, but we are not salty, then the question is, how is the earth going to get salty? It's interesting to note in that first line, kind of look at it there in verse 13, where Jesus says, how shall its saltiness be restored? I think we often think that that's talking about our saltiness being restored, but the "its" is really referring to the earth. If we don't provide that flavor, if we don't provide that to the world, then the question is, how is the world going to receive it? Jesus is saying to his disciples, it's not the responsibility of everybody else out there. It's the calling of those who call the Father, Father. It's ours. So he starts with using this metaphor of salt. And whether salt is used for preservation or for taste, honestly, that is not what matters. What matters is, are we providing the purpose of salt? Are we providing the purpose for which God has called us into the world? As disciples. If we don't, who will? And he says, if you don't do that, if salt loses its saltiness, what is it good for? It's really good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. Now, Jesus is not threatening his disciples by this. That would be a wrong understanding. He's not threatening his disciples. He's just speaking the reality of the way things are. For disciples who don't live out the calling to which God has called them to be a part of. It made sense to the hearers. What do you do with salt that isn't salty? It's a way to kind of get their attention about the calling that God has called them to. Jesus says the same thing about the light of the world, and this is where we're going to spend a little bit more time today. He says, you are the light of the world. You are the Father's light into a dark world. You are that light. You can't be hidden. And for that matter, why would you want to be? Two things about light. As the light of the world, you cannot be hidden. And if you could, why would you want to be? And so to help them understand this, he kind of gives them a couple object lessons. It's almost like a children's message on the Mount of Beatitudes. He gives them two. And the first one is in verse 14. He says, a city on a hill cannot be hidden. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. When Jesus said this, it would have been very easy for him to just speak into his disciples and just give a quick glance across the Sea of Galilee to the city called Hippus. If you look on this picture, this is the Sea of Galilee. About over in this area right here is the Mount of Beatitudes where Jesus is speaking these words. And right here is this hill. And on this hill is built the city of Hippus. Hippus was a center of Greek and Roman culture. It was a flourishing, beautiful city. It was on the eastern shore of the Sea of Galilee. And Hippus, on that hill, would have had a grand theater that would have been there. There was a temple that is believed to have been about 70 feet high. Think seven stories on top of that hill. In other words, it was there and was built up for people to be able to see and be impressed. I mean, why else would you build a city on that hill? Water, getting that was a lot more difficult. Access to it was more restricted. There's only one reason you'd build that city on that hill, and that is because you wanted to be seen. Hippus wanted to be seen. Whether it was during the day or lit up at night, to shine out into the darkness. Everyone on the mountain that Jesus was speaking on knew about Hippus. They knew where Hippus was. It could not be hidden. So too are we as disciples of Jesus. We cannot be hidden. It's the nature of our identity. It's the nature of who we are as Jesus followers. If we follow Jesus, if we follow Jesus the way he called us to follow him, we will stand out. We will be different than the rest of the world. We cannot hide from who we are unless we're not who we say we are. See, our calling is to live extraordinary lives in ordinary ways. In a sense, that's the message from Isaiah today. In verse 7, is it not our calling, just like Isaiah, or just like God says through Isaiah, is it not our calling to do something that the rest of the world might not do? To share our bread with the hungry? To bring the homeless poor into your own house? To clothe those who are unclothed? And then, he says, then your light shall break forth like the dawn. when we do those kinds of things, our light breaks forth in the dawn. Our calling is to live extraordinary lives in ordinary ways. To be an extraordinary father or mother. To be an extraordinary employee or an extraordinary neighbor or an extraordinary friend. We are called to be extraordinary in our faithfulness, to be extraordinary in our purity, to be extraordinary in our love, in our generosity, in our patience, in our kindness, in our forgiveness, in our self-control, and the list could go on. Hippas was not built to be an ordinary city. We have not received the forgiveness of sins and the grace of God because of the life of Jesus, because of the death and resurrection of Jesus. We have not received that grace and forgiveness just to be like everyone else. It's not what God has called us to do. We did not receive the absolution today. And we will not receive the Lord's Supper today in just a moment so we can go back and fit in with the rest of the world and be hidden amongst them. It is not who we are, first of all. And second of all, why would we do that anyway? It actually would make no sense. And that's Jesus' second object lesson in verse 15. In verse 15, he says, "Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house." There's a lamp, and there's its stand. You see, the typical house in Israel in Jesus' day would have looked very much like this. This is actually a reconstructed first century village in the area of the Sea of Galilee. So this would have been a kind of town that Jesus would have gone through, and the houses have been restored back to where they would have been in the first century. And when you look at a house like that, the houses are generally pretty dark. You can see there's a little bit of light that comes in. And so to help people function in these houses, they would have had oil lamps that would have been lit and placed on a lampstand. And actually, right by this guy's leg is that lampstand. And that's what it looks like. It's simply a rock that would have been built into the wall, and you would have put the lamp on it right there. There's the stand, and there's the lamp. You see, people would have very much understood this simple illustration that Jesus used in the Sermon on the Mount. No one lights his lamp, has it in the house, lights it, puts it on the stand, and then covers it up. I mean, that just doesn't make sense, does it? I mean, that's really a pretty silly thing to do. And that's the point that Jesus is trying to make. It doesn't make any sense to have the blessing of life with Jesus and then cover it up with our worldly pleasures and priorities, or hide it with mere earthly pursuits and passions. That just doesn't make sense. Why would you do that? Why would a follower, a disciple of Jesus, do that? You see, we serve a most wonderful and useful purpose to the world, just like that lamp does to the house. One that no one else in the world can do. to bring light to the good news of Jesus Christ and his love and his forgiveness and God's mercy that is found in a world of darkness. We have been called to live extraordinary lives in very ordinary ways. Take a look at that lamp again. There's nothing fancy about that little oil lamp. In fact, if you went to some of the archaeological sites, you would find remnants and broken pieces of those things all over the place. They were a dime a dozen. That's nothing fancy. There's nothing fancy about it. It's ordinary, but it does something that nothing else in the house can do. So why wouldn't you let it shine? Why wouldn't we let the light of Christ shine in the darkness of the world in which we live? So that what is true would come to the light, so that it would be clearly seen that the works have been carried out by God. John chapter 3. And so that understanding kind of brings us back to the garage. Long ago, and the light that I held for my father. The light that I held was pretty much for one purpose. The light I held was for the working of my Father. My being his light did not make me to be his son. I already was. And my weak arms and distracted mind, when that light wavered, did not disqualify me as his son. My being his light was about being the light for him to do his work. And when the job was done, and my mother came out and said, "Good job," she wasn't talking about how I held the light. Honestly, she really wasn't even necessarily talking about how my dad turned the wrench. What she was excited about was that the car was fixed. And she'd have a smooth ride from then on. In the same way, Jesus says, "Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." So that they may give glory to God for fixing that which was broken, for restoring the reign of heaven in the world. That is who we are. That is our identity. That is our calling. We are disciples of Jesus. We are salt and we are light to the world. And now may the peace that passes our understanding guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting.